So what are some methods that we use to form carboxylic acids? The first one we'll look at is oxidation of primary alcohols. Remember this back in the oxidations and reductions chapter. We do a Jones oxidation, which is chromium trioxide with acid. And remember that will oxidize our alcohol all the way up to the carboxylic acid. If we wanted it to stop at the aldehyde, we had a reaction to do that too. Instead, we would use pyridinium chlorochromate, and that would oxidize our primary alcohol up to the aldehyde, and it would stop there. If we want to oxidize it all the way up to the carboxylic acid, we would do a Jones oxidation. Another reaction that we just learned last chapter is the oxidation of alkyl benzenes. So if we have a carbon here, and any number of carbons here, as long as there's at least one benzylic proton, that will oxidize any of those molecules all up to the same structure, and it's always up to the benzoic acid. So if that's how we form carboxylic acids, the next thing we want to know is what reactions can we do with the carboxylic acid. The first reaction that carboxylic acids undergo is they just react as an acid. And an acid is something that donates a proton. And if we want to think about why this would happen, if the base comes by, pulls off this proton, this lone pair, then goes on to oxygen, forming the carboxylate anion. Now, why would that happen? It happens because this carboxylate anion is stabilized through resonance. So if we're going to try and decide what kind of bases can pull this proton off, we need to return to pKas. You have to remember that carboxylic acids typically have a pKa on the order of 4 to 5. So what we need to do is we need to look at the conjugate acid of any base that we're thinking of using to remove the acidic proton. Let's say we use something with OH in it. Okay, this can be KOH, potassium hydroxide, it can be sodium hydroxide. So the important thing you need to consider then is, of course, what is the conjugate acid of OH minus? The conjugate acid is water. The pKa of water is 15.74. So now we have to compare the two pKas. Which one between the carboxylic acid and the water is more willing to give up its proton? Remember, a smaller pKa means more acidic, which is more willing to give up its proton. So if we have a choice between the carboxylic acid keeping its proton or the hydroxide taking it, the hydroxide will take it. To make either sodium or potassium propionate in this case, or the carboxylate salt of sodium or potassium plus water. So that's a relatively strong base of hydroxide. What about something weaker like bicarbonate? So again, I have my propionic acid with a pKa in the range of 4 to 5, and now I'm going to react with sodium bicarbonate. Again, we have to look at what the conjugate acid is. The conjugate acid of sodium bicarbonate is carbonic acid, H2CO3, which has a pKa of 6.4. Once again, we have to compare these to the propionic acid to the carbonic acid. We see that, once again, this is a stronger acid. So even sodium bicarbonate is a strong enough acid to deprotonate our carboxylic acid to form the carboxylate and H2CO3, or carbonic acid. So back in chapter 2, we talked briefly about inductive effects and how they affect the acidity of any given molecule by anything that will stabilize the conjugate base. Electron withdrawing groups pull electron density away from the point of the charge, thus delocalizing the charge, therefore making the conjugate base more stable and making the molecule more acidic. Likewise, then, an electron donating group pushes electron density toward the point of the charge, further localizing the charge, which makes the conjugate base less stable and makes the molecule a weaker acid. So with those two rules, we should be able to look at two molecules like acetic acid and two chloroacetic acid and determine which one should be more acidic and thus have the lower pKa. As we've seen lots of times up until now, acetic acid has a pKa of close to 4.8. So now we have to guess what the pKa of chloroacetic acid is going to be. Well, the first thing you need to think about is whether or not chlorine is going to inductively pull electron density away or push electron density towards the carboxylic acid. And chlorine is more electronegative than carbon, so it will be pulling electron density away. What we find out is that the pKa of chloroacetic acid is about 2.8. Now, if you had to guess what would happen if we put a second chlorine on, if one chlorine atom pulls electron density away inductively, what would two chlorine atoms do? They're both pulling electron density away, so they should both be stabilizing the negative charge. So if we think about it, here's what we're talking about. These more electronegative atoms pull electron density away from this charge, and this charge then becomes delocalized. Which makes this carboxylic anion more stable, which then makes it easier for this carboxylic acid to give up its proton. And the pKa of this is 1.3. If we add a third chlorine onto our carboxylic acid, again, I hope that you would guess that the pKa continues to go down as this becomes more acidic. And you may not be able to guess the exact numbers. I never care whether or not you memorize a number. It's the trend that is important to understand, is that every time we put another electronegative group on here, it's going to pull more electron density away from the carboxylate anion and further stabilize it. So this ends up being 0.9 pKa. The next item to consider is what happens if we put a more inductively electron withdrawing atom on in place of the chlorine. So as we go from having no electron withdrawing group to a pretty good electron withdrawing group, chlorine, to a better electron withdrawing group, fluorine, what should happen to the pKa? And again, I wouldn't expect you to be able to guess the number, but I would expect you to be able to guess that it goes down, as fluoroacetic acid is more acidic than chloroacetic acid. Now, we don't have very many electron donating groups, but if you remember, alkyl groups are slightly electron donating. So if we have 2,2-dimethylpropanoic acid, we have three electron donating groups pushing electron density this way, thus destabilizing our carboxylate. And since that destabilizes the carboxylate, the original carboxylic acid should be less acidic than acetic acid, and indeed that's the case, where the pKa is 5.1. It's somewhat less acidic than acetic acid is because of the electron donating groups. The next piece to consider is how far away the electron withdrawing group is from the carboxylic acid. So if we consider a 2-chloro versus 3-chloro versus 4-chloro, well, once again, I wouldn't expect you to be able to memorize or know the exact numbers of the pKas. I would expect you to be able to look at the structures and determine what the trend should be as far as which one should be most acidic to which one should be least acidic. And as it turns out, the closer the electron withdrawing group is to the carboxylic acid, the greater the inductive effect will be. So the pKa of 2-chlorobutanoic acid is 2.9, while 3-chlorobutanoic acid is 4.1. And 4-chlorobutanoic acid is 4.5. So there's a pretty strong effect, a fairly small effect, and a very nominal effect as we move the electron withdrawing group further away from where the charge would be.